Hello and welcome back to the Digital Health and Wearables series. Today I have another magnificent episode for you, but before I go ahead, please make sure you subscribe and check all the magnificent content previous to this recording. And also let me acknowledge our digital health platform, Clinitouch V, and our series partner, Fujifilm Healthcare. And it gives me great pleasure to introduce you today to Craig Lipset. Is a co-chair of the Decentralized Trials and Research Institute, Alliance, not Institute, and also is the Managing Director at Clinical Innovation Partners, and is also the Vice Chair at MedStar Health Research Institute. Craig, how are you?
I'm very well. How are you today?
I'm doing well. Nice to see you, and thanks so much for taking the time.
Hey, it's really a pleasure to be here. Thanks for having me.
Brilliant. And today we are here to discuss decentralized clinical trials. And I'm going ahead with the questions. Is that okay, Craig?
Well, let's go.
Brilliant. And the first question that I have for you is, can you share some of the main trends and realities in the adoption of decentralized trials?
Hey, that's a great first question, because as recently as a few years ago, adoption of decentralized trials was really very nascent. In fact, at a conference a little over 2 years ago, I shared a slide that emphasized the oversupply of capabilities in the market. That 2.5 years ago, we had many CROs and tech companies announcing that they had some form of capability. We had a handful of young venture-backed companies that had raised, you know, respectable amount of money at the time, probably around $100 million in investment in aggregate across the ecosystem prior to the pandemic. But what we were struggling with in terms of adoption was meaningful adoption. We had a cluster of experiments or pilots in different pharma companies, but little more than that. Most companies, you would rarely have seen more than a single experiment or maybe a cluster of four or five. During the initial stages of the lockdown, you saw clinical trials across therapeutic areas across the world really placed in jeopardy in terms of continuity. That meant that it was a question on people's minds if we would be able to keep getting investigational product study drug to patients that were relying on it. Could we continue to monitor people for their safety? Could we continue to collect efficacy data that we relied on as the purpose for doing these trials? And that's where many of these decentralized solutions that had been available but struggling for adoption suddenly got bought up very quickly. And so in that late spring, summer of 2020, we certainly saw this spike of adoption, but it wasn't adoption done in a sustaining way. It was adoption done out of urgency. It was adoption in 2020 that relied on SOP waivers and protocol deviations, all of which implied these were temporary countermeasures. I think it wasn't until last year, 2021, that we started to see in earnest signs of sustaining change. And what that started to look like last year were pharma companies that were reviewing and modifying SOPs, changing training, looking at their landscape of partners and identifying where they might have had gaps around services and technologies in this category, looking at their protocol templates to identify if there's language that needed to be changed, and really starting to stand up, go forward, sustaining models that try to make sure that decentralized methods were given appropriate consideration during study design and planning, really moving us beyond that 2020 sprint scramble of adoption in 21, more of this sustaining view. I think as we're here where we are right now and entering the second quarter of 2022, we see most of the large pharma now have some form of version 1.0 of decentralized understood. using video, using maybe mobile devices or technologies, digital for e-consent, self-reporting of data, maybe some with the ability to connect and pull in other sensor data, and pairing those technologies with different process changes in their organization, using home health and visiting nurses, or using local imaging centers and local labs to be able to acquire specimens that could be centrally reviewed, and extending their supply chain so that drug can reach patients from home. And what we're starting to see now is a little bit of version 1.1 starting to emerge, with some renewed experiments around where trials can take place beyond just clinics and beyond just the home. How do we bring these trials into retail clinics, pop-up sites, mobile units, community practices? So we've certainly seen this very healthy progression and stabilization of our decentralized models in many companies. Wouldn't say we're fully at scale yet. It's still very hard to implement consistently on a global basis. There's still a lot of change effort that's needed to bring study teams along, but there are great signs in terms of sustaining these approaches that were adopted during the pandemic.
Well, brilliant. I mean, Craig, thank you so much for that comprehensive and amazing overview. My intake is that, I mean, we have still many challenges. Adoption is kind of changing in a new phase. You mentioned the 1.0, a new phase, and adoption is certainly taking off in a different way. Yeah, it's very interesting and also exciting times ahead, because now I start also to feel you more inside of the industry, of course, but I'm starting to feel like things are starting to happen, which is great. Moving on to the second question. And the second question that I have for you is, how health tech and wearables are impacting clinical trials?
Now, this is a great question. And I would break out some of the health tech wearable space into a couple of different use cases when we think about clinical trials. There are our known measurements, and then there are the unknown measurements, right? So we have the things we've always measured as possible endpoints for studies: heart rate, blood pressure, other discrete physiologic measures. Can we use a connected device in order to capture a known physiologic measure outside of a traditional clinical research site? Many studies have done that for years. Ambulatory blood pressure monitoring has been incrementally adopted in various studies where additional measurements were needed outside of a conventional clinical center visit. And so some of these connected devices have been used for some time and continue to see some adoption. I think the part where we've struggled to drive a more scalable, innovative approach is as we think about the unknown measures, our ability to develop new digital endpoints, new digital measurements for our studies, which are in many ways some of the exquisite power and some of the most exciting potential that these connected devices bring. Think about a measure like the 6-minute walk test, which has been used for years in clinical research studies from heart failure to movement disorders. A 6-minute walk test typically requires a patient to come to a research site where the hallway is marked off with 20-meter distance with cones or tape on the floor, and the patient walks back and forth for 6 minutes being monitored. And we know that we could collect the same or better data with a connected device on the patient's wrist or in their pocket or somewhere else on their person. But doing so for a particular therapeutic area requires time, budget, planning. It requires an investment to be made before that study started in order to qualify that measurement for that particular patient population and indication. And I think that's where we're falling short right now. Most pharma, large pharma organizations that have built up some digital medicine capability really can only accommodate a small number of digital measurements at any one time. We don't have a thick pipeline to be able to validate and qualify new measures through. There are some collaborations that exist to do so, but they tend to be very big and expensive and a little clunky. I think there are some interesting innovative approaches that groups like DIME, the Digital Medicine Society, are experimenting with, and I think that's extremely important right now. because so much of our aspiration to decentralize will ultimately be rate limited by our ability to measure endpoints that matter outside of a traditional clinical site and become more location agnostic. And our current model of developing and qualifying these measures is just too long and costly and burdensome until we come up with some of these much more efficient and collaborative ways to do so.
Oh, brilliant. Craig, thank you so much. You know, I'm a fan of wearables. I really feel like sometimes the wearables are the solution, but also they bring another layer of complexity around the deviation of the data and the reliability. I have many other challenges too. But also they bring that capability of doing things remotely. And you, for this purpose of decentralized the clinical trials, they're certainly a very reliable option. Thank you so much for that. Moving on to the third and last question. And what I would like to ask you to finalize is, what do you expect for the next generation of clinical trials by 2030?
That's an exciting question. I think we see a lot of great trends and signals of what is to come. Certainly, decentralized is coming into its own right, and we will start to uncover some of these better and smarter ways to develop and qualify digital measurements together. But some of the other trends that we're seeing out there right now include the support and the impact of master protocols in clinical research, umbrella and bucket and platform studies. What these are referring to is that traditional research studies involve creating a ton of infrastructure to answer one research question, writing a protocol, building a network of sites, developing a data management plan, recruiting participants, all to answer one protocol's question about one medicine, and then dismantle it all after that study concludes. Master protocols allow us the opportunity to have sustaining infrastructure to answer questions about multiple medicines over time, even from different manufacturers. We saw this before the pandemic in oncology indications in the US with studies like I-SPY 2 and LungMap. But during the pandemic, we really saw the impact coming from Europe with some of the master protocols that the World Health Organization had catalyzed, like Solidarity and Recovery. These studies really answered so many of the most important questions for us about which therapies were making an impact. The FDA and other regulators have been very supportive of master protocols. And so as we think about our future, how will we start to see more people enrolled in research? Not in one trial for Pfizer versus one trial for Merck versus one for Novartis, but into prospective research platforms. We see signals of that when we look at the All of Us research study from the NIH or Verily's Project Baseline as examples. Enroll all comers, invite people to share their data. What happens when those are no longer just observational studies, but inviting people to use an intervention over time? We even see this on our iPhones today. If we take a look at the Apple Research app, not Research Kit, but the Research app itself, where I can enroll in multiple different types of studies from one research application, have access to my health data through the health Apple Health interfaces, and choose to share it with my permission through a single interface. So I think that this convergence of master protocols and decentralized with wearables will all start to stitch together. I think the last element that I just hinted at is this ability for me as a person to connect my electronic health data from various sources and bring that into these research platforms. Moving beyond just asking me to self-report data or even just to put on a device, but for me to have the power to access electronic health record data wherever it exists about me and be able to share that into these research platforms. By 2030, I really am excited about what these pieces will look like as they come together and reach new scale.
Oh, brilliant. Fantastic. Craig, what a brilliant way to finish. And I'm not sure if you're aware of this, but I finish all my episodes. It's not really a question as such. It's called 1 minute of fame. Over to you. You can mention anything. A shout out to a company, your great professional work, personal achievements, anything whatsoever. Over to you before I round up. 1 minute of fame.
For my 1 minute, what I'd love to call out is this has been a remarkable year, I think, for the clinical research industry, the last 2 years, in terms of sustaining pipelines and portfolios. And people have really risen to the challenge in keeping these studies going. This has really been a period not of innovation, but of adoption. And what I'd love to call out for people is, how do we sustain the willingness to adopt? Let's not wait for another global pandemic just to drive the adoption of new innovations that have been backlogged and accumulating at our feet, waiting to be implemented. How do we keep this mindset of willingness to take thoughtful risk, to embed new approaches in our studies? We did it during the pandemic. How do we keep doing it beyond the pandemic?
Oh, brilliant. Craig, thank you so much for the incredible insights. Thank you so much for your time, for being in here, and your magnificent work.
Thank you for keeping this conversation going. It was a pleasure.
Brilliant. I'm going to round up now to all our viewers and listeners. Make sure you subscribe to the channel. Also, I'm going to post the links to connect with Craig. Connect with him on LinkedIn and on Twitter. Follow his amazing work. And to finalize, acknowledge our digital health platform, CliniTouch V, and our series partner, Fujifilm Healthcare. I'll see you all next week.